kind of products did we say that looks really interesting?
Wow, does anybody remember what the you should ask Roman Loyola?
That was 2 days ago.
That was 2 days ago. Yeah, that was like, man,
that's a lifetime in there.
Right. That was. Well, there was a nice mix. I mean, we had some iOS accessories, and we also had some Mac stuff. There were the OWC has these SSDs, these flash drives for the MacBook Air, where they basically the flash drive in the MacBook Air is this new slot thing that Apple invented, and you can get that storage from Apple. But OWC is now selling the stuff that is much faster than the stock storage and much larger. And for example, like the 11-inch MacBook Air, you can't even get in the largest mm-hmm. configurations. And from OWC, you can get that stuff. And you just pop out the one and pop in the OWC one, and you get this super fast and really reliable. So we gave that a Best of Show.
Right.
I was really disappointed that the iGrill didn't get Best of Show, but we can talk about that later. I'm still a little bitter on that. It makes me very sad.
You'll never know if your meats
busy,
are cooked now.
Busy to do from Busy Mac, which is over there in the indie showcase, which is, you know, baffling that iCal does to-dos, but there are no to-do iCal sync thing on your
later.
iPhone,
right.
Even now. And apparently, talking to Busy Mac, they kept delaying making it because they figured any day now Apple would fix that, and they still haven't done it. So that now you can get, it's actually 99 cents for the weekend.
Wow.
You can get Busy To-Do, and it's basically another app on your iPhone that syncs your iCal to-dos over MobileMe. Which is just a huge hole. So, I mean, those are some of them. There were 10 in
there was,
in
was
all.
One that I've seen a lot of our Macworld editors using, which is Boom.
Oh, Boom, yes.
Yeah, which is something that basically lets you raise the volume on your Mac higher than just if you, like, turn it up all the way.
It really goes to 11.
For laptops.
It's really made for laptops because they have very small speakers and you can only get them so loud. But we were using some of them in the press room earlier to watch, you know, watch some of these videos that we've been live streaming, for example.
Yeah.
And it makes a big difference. We had to turn it down because it was too loud in the press room.
Yeah, well, it's the same technique that they use to make all the commercials in between your TV shows seem ridiculously loud. It's not just that they're louder volume. It's that they're compressed so that, like, the dynamic range is really squashed, and it's this just super noisy all the time kind of thing. But on Boom, that's actually really great because it makes it easier for you to hear things that might otherwise have been too quiet.
Maybe in a future version they'll make it so it actually sounds like TV commercials too. Every video that you play will sound like a loud TV commercial.
It'll just play music in the background, and there'll be an announcer who comes on.
1995 and two easy payments.
That would be worst of show.
Now, Dan Frakes, you're a Mac Gems person. I imagine that you have probably seen a few gems here on the show floor. Although it's, I think for those of you who aren't here, how many of you feel that there was a reasonable representation of Mac OS software? Okay.
Four of you?
A few. But we had an awful lot of iOS software, right? Yes. And did you go to the booths and check out some of the stuff that was being shown?
I was going to say, I wonder, we've been saying this for years. In 2003, it was, my gosh, the whole show was iPod cases, right? And then it was, in 2008, it was, the whole show was iPhone cases. I don't really know if it's changed that much overall. It's just that instead of iPod cases, it was iPhone cases. Now it's iPad cases. I think the big difference is there's no big, you know, there's no huge, huge Apple booths or Adobe booths, and so everything seems smaller. But I saw a good amount of Mac software here that I didn't expect.
I think there's a decent amount of cross-platform stuff too that takes advantage of features on both the Mac. Like you mentioned, the Busy To Do, for example. Like there's software that's about gluing together. You have an iPhone and a Mac. You know, how do you make these things work together? I'm looking over. There's a SuperSync over there. There's a few other syncing solutions, but I think they've started to realize more and more that there are, you know, people, well, they might originally get an iPhone, you know, 50, like the Apple keeps saying, 50% of the people who buy Macs are new to Macs, so they probably are coming from the iPhone user base. So there's lots of people with iPhones and Macs and now in iPads too, and so there's certainly a large potential for having products that help you manage all those various devices you're now carrying around.
Right. Now, I mean, certainly one trend here is the iPad appears to be very popular. And everybody wants cases because maybe they've just recently got them over the holidays and they're not quite sure which case to get. And here, there's plenty of opportunity to look at cases here.
Yeah. But what's hard, too. I mean, iPad, we can make fun of the fact that there are lots of iPad cases, but the iPad's a product that kind of wants to be in a case.
Yeah.
at least some of the time, if not all the time. And we know, you know, we're fortunate that especially Dan Frakes, he's so fortunate, he gets every single
fortunate
iPad.
Is an interesting fortunate choice of words.
Every single iPad case that is possibly made gets sent to Dan Frakes' house, and then he has to figure out who the heck's going to review it, and he has boxes and boxes, and but we're fortunate in the sense that we can try them all out and form opinions about what I like and what I don't like, and then we write our reviews, and that's a service we can provide to people who don't get to do that. One of the nice things about being a Macworld Expo is you actually can look at the cases,
right,
and say, oh, I don't like this one. Oh, this one's nice.
Yeah.
And that's actually a lot stronger than looking at a website where there are a couple of, you know, maybe even photoshopped pictures of the case.
Right.
It doesn't tell you the story.
I also see a lot of people carrying around their iPads, using them instead of using a MacBook, for example. And this is kind of a crowdsourcing opportunity as well. Okay, people in the audience, hold up your iPads. If anybody has any iPad.
It's like a concert. There's
yeah, well, they have to go into iPad, their so. Purses and their bags to show them. Right. So let's see. There's an Apple case. There's a... I don't know what that is. You got that at the grocery store. Apple case. Nice.
That is a lot of Apple cases.
Okay, so apparently the Apple case is pretty popular.
Pretty popular.
And so that's helpful. I mean, I happen to have an Apple case, too, and I held off a long time getting one because I wasn't quite sure. But as I would go to the office or I'd go to user group meetings or something, I would look and see what are people using. So I think at this show, this is also that opportunity that I look in the speaker's lounge or I look at people carrying around their iPads and trying to look at what they're using. And that, to me, is really a good recommendation, in addition to going to the booth, so I can see what people have settled on after considering one or any number of our iPad case reviews, which fortunately we've ranked and have sort of an area for, so people can pick out our favorites. But I think that's one of the big benefits here is that we have the opportunity to interact with other Apple enthusiasts and see what people are doing. And big deal.
Well, and speaking of just impressions of the show, I think something that's very, it stands out, is so you see all these vendors selling iPad cases, and you see the software showcase with all these iPad apps, and you see all these accessories. The iPad didn't even exist a year ago.
Right.
And that's amazing to me that there's an entire industry and, you know, a third of a show for an item that didn't even exist. And that when it started to exist, people said, oh, it's not going to do that well.
Well, and how full featured things are. I mean, I visited with one iOS app developer who had made an entire project management software for the iPad. And it was really, you know, in-depth and really powerful. He says, you know, lots of people in businesses have been asking for something like this on the iPad. And he was as surprised as I think we've all heard, you know, all these stories, especially, again, when Apple's touting how many people in the enterprise, how many big companies are using the iPad from an industry that is traditionally really slow to adopt new technology.
It's been 10 months.
Yeah. And
that's it.
It's a huge number of businesses that are actually using the iPad, which is astounding. I mean, having previously worked at a large institution, you know,
It usually takes years
to change something like that. But I think it's a testament to just how powerful and how useful it is, which is, again, surprising because I remember us all sitting around a year ago talking about, What are we going to use this for? Is it going to be useful? And all of a sudden, you know, I feel like we've been hypnotized in a good way.
Huh. Oh, the good kind of hypnotized. Well, we didn't know, right? We had, some of us were very lucky to go to that event when they announced it and spend 20 minutes with our hands on it. But it was a mystery, impossible to tell
from there, like, what it would turn into. I mean, I think we were all, not to say we weren't optimistic about it, but, like, there was also a, okay, all right, interesting, but is there more?
Yeah, and what are we going to do with this thing?
Yeah.
And I think that answer is different for a lot of people, that you really sort of, you outfit it a way that's very personal. And so maybe I pick up somebody else's iPad and I go, what's this doing on here? You know, where's Angry Birds? You know, otherwise I feel lost.
And it goes down to the case too, right? Because the different cases actually fit in there. If you need something that's rugged, if you want something that looks like it's a book, if you want something that you can prop up horizontally so you can watch a video or prop up vertically or work with a keyboard. And I mean, that's one of the reasons why there are so many iPad cases is there's so many different iPad uses. The Apple case is probably the best kind of cross trainer, probably because the designer of that case was the first case designer to actually be able to use an iPad.
Right.
Just like, guessing.
Oh, you might want to use it.
You'd think that there are plenty of people who would have like come up with something that equals it, and yet how many people did we just see still using Apple cases? Like, even if they were the first, I mean...
Well, I only review the Folio cases. I've reviewed, like, 20 of those, and I've got another 10 or 15 on the way, Dan, I should say. Dan, they're coming. And there's only like a handful, maybe three or four that I like better than the Apple case. I mean, the Apple case, it turns out, when people saw it, they're like,
perfect,
yeah, it's kind of weird.
But it turns out works it's pretty good. Well, is the point, like design.
It's functional, yeah. Right.
Okay, so iPad aside, you guys have been over to the iOS, you looked at the iOS apps. Is there a trend now in iOS apps? I mean, when they first came out, there were a lot of fart apps because you could do it. And we've sort of cleared through that. And then iPad apps came up when...
the farts have cleared?
Yeah,
is that what you're saying?
Yes, yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Thank you.
Yes, that cleared. And thank you. So then, and then iPad apps started ramping up. And now they're going pretty well. So where are we now in kind of a trend of iOS apps? Are we seeing as much sort of stuff that just can be made and so it is? Or are we starting to filter down now to have certain kind of utilities where you have this device and this is a good purpose for it and so we make apps to do that?
Well, I'll say that we get press releases every day. I would say, 30, 50?
I have like 50 messages in my mailbox waking up in the morning.
Just from press releases about new iPad and iOS apps. Over the last maybe 6 months, a lot of those are the kind of things that someone at home might use, a lot of recipes, a lot of educational things. But stuff for kids, I think I see more often than anything else. And
games.
Yeah, well, games, right. Yeah. But then we talked about this a year ago. We said, you know what, this is the kind of thing that will be great for kids because you've taken the abstractness of a mouse out and everything is interacting directly with what's on the screen. And I think that's starting to bear out because now we're seeing literally 15, 20 press releases for educational things a day.
Well, and I think that the market has matured a bit in that.
We got all the fart apps out of the way.
Well, I mean, part of that, but also because, you know, we now have over 300,000 apps on the iOS App Store. And, you know, to a certain extent, it seems like, hard to say if all the obvious, you know, ideas have been done, but we have all seen things like it's a writing application, it's a drawing application, it's a timer, it's a recipe application. So I think we're seeing more of a challenge for developers to come up with something that's going to get them noticed, to do something that's interesting. And so I think we started to hit this second wave where there's maybe a lower volume, but when something comes out that is interesting, it's really even more interesting for the fact that we haven't seen it done this way, or they're working harder on taking an idea that someone else has done and implementing it in a way that's better than what's been done before. So I think we're starting to enter that phase of refining what we have already seen.
Yeah, I think the whole education aspect is interesting because when we got the iPad, we all thought, okay, the buzz was bigger iPod Touch, so what? But I think educators were immediately interested in looking at that as a reference tool and an information tool. And I know that we had discussions with publishers and other people who said, okay, how do we take our content and make it dynamic on here? And I think the one danger was that this was going to become the CD-ROM of the 21st century, that we're like, yeah, okay, it'll just be stuff with like movies embedded and sounds that and the interfaces are cluttered. And I think we're starting to get an idea about how these things can be designed. But do we need Apple to lead the way on that and provide publishing tools for this sort of thing? Or is it going to continue kind of as in the publishing industry that, no, you have to build your own app and there is no real standard. You're just going to have to reinvent the wheel. Every developer has to do this.
I mean, my fear is that Apple... I mean, it's a good thing in the sense that Apple may not know what the right approach is for textbooks or for newspapers or for magazines, and so by letting the publishers figure it out, rather than sort of just, you know, closing their eyes and throwing a dart at the wall and saying, here, try this, fill this format, then you'd have people screaming, you know, this doesn't work with our format, why are you making a shoehorn it in this way? The downside of it is, of course, that developing apps is really expensive, and you're starting from zero, and you end up with how many apps on your device that all behave differently, and you don't know how to use one. How to use the New York Times versus the Washington Post? How you? So, you know, it's an interesting question. I think over time Apple will probably provide more hooks for content, you know, publishers to work more within an ecosystem like we've seen with iBooks.
Right.
But Apple only has so much energy to devote to any of these projects, and I think that it's in some ways, it feels like the platform is so compelling that the newspapers and magazines and all these other publishers are going to put in the investment to make it happen, that Apple doesn't need to worry about it so much. If Apple perceives it being a problem, then that's what will motivate Apple to jump in and try to solve it.
There's also, I mean, you know, the iPad, before it came out, everybody had this whole expectation. There was this whole idea that it's going to save journalism, like overnight, right? You're going to wake up the next day, and all of a sudden all the newspapers are going to be profitable, and it's going to be unicorns, and everyone's going to be happy. And it didn't happen, you know, like that. And again, it's been a rough, I think, adoption process for a lot of the publications. A lot of people have tried things that don't, you know, they've gone through a couple iterations, some of them, like the Times and other things, refining those and trying to figure out what does work. And I think Apple, again, I agree, I think Apple will get there or provide some things that make it easier to hook into stuff. But I think a lot of the publications are having to sort of find their own way into what makes a successful thing, especially for their own readership, because it differs. You know, the people who are reading Wired on their iPad may not be the people reading The New Yorker on their iPad. They might be, but, you know, it could be potentially two very different audiences. And so while they do have some things in common, just in the, you know, the fact that they're both publications or providing content, they might want to provide that content in different forms or in different, you know, subscription models or what have you. And so I think we're still seeing them coming to terms with what the future is going to look like for their particular publication.
Okay, let's switch gears, and let's talk about the show as a show. Last year was the first year that Apple was not here, and I think a lot of people had questions. Will this be a successful show without Apple? I think that Paul Kent and the management team proved that it was a workable show. It was definitely smaller. People came with mixed expectations, but that was kind of behind us. So, like, yes, we can pull off an expo, and we're going to do it again, and we did it this year. So, first of all, what kind of expectations did you come in with? What did you see from seeing the show? Does it seem like this is really a working model? This is something that we can continue to go forward with? Or are we just sort of treading water, hoping that Apple will come back, which, of course, they never will?
I look at them, they look at me. I guess I'll answer this. I don't know what my expectations were. I like the fact that it's all in one building in Moscone West and not one of those sort of, well, go over there for this, go over here for that. I understand that the number of exhibitors is up, masked a little bit by the fact that there are exhibitors in these small spaces where they're sort of sharing a kiosk with a couple other people.
Right.
The show floor has been crowded. The feedback that I've gotten from the conferences has been good. Apple's not coming back. I think some of it is just about comparing it to the past more than it is about what the show is, what it is. If you started with no show and you said, wow, you know, Apple's going great and there's lots of stuff going on in all the markets around Apple, the accessories and the software for the apps for the iOS and the Mac software and Mac accessories and iOS accessories, there's a lot there. Maybe we should do like a trade show and a conference to take advantage of the fact that Apple's so big and is so successful. And if you said that, somebody would probably say, yeah, that's a good idea. But, you know, instead, Apple's departure has made people sort of judge it as, well, you know, when Apple was here, Apple had a big booth and there were other big booths. So some of it is about your perspective, I think, more than anything else.
Yeah. I think the...
You want to hear why Apple might be coming? I will just say that this gentleman has some ideas about why Apple will come back here, and I will say, in the politest way possible, you are delusional. It is never going to happen.
It's.
No, it won't happen.
We've
just shouted you down.
I don't think. I don't think it's going to happen. Apple. I think Apple would have to be in a state of vulnerability where it felt like it was again necessary to. To to reach out in a way. And you know, with the success of the retail stores and the and from a media gathering point of view, Apple can send out an invitation with, I used to say 2 weeks, but now they can do it with a week's notice or a couple of days' notice and get everybody in the press who they want to be there to come to Cupertino or wherever they say, New York or San Francisco, to go to their events. So from their perspective, I'm not sure they need it. I think it would be great if they came back, but I don't think they will.
Yeah, I mean, what other company can you think of that can issue an electronic invitation to a handful of media outlets and generate 3 days of news of people looking just at the invitation through a microscope to try to read the tea leaves that tell you what are they going to possibly do? Even if it's like the September music event, we know exactly what they're going to do. They're going to release new iPods, and they're going to update the iTunes store.
Look how much buzz they generated for changing their homepage before the Beatles announcement, right?
Right.
They didn't even issue an invitation, and yet everybody was convinced it was going to be, was this a new MacBooks? Is it a new iPhone? No, it's the Beatles.
Yeah. Or even if the iTunes store shuts down or the Apple store shuts down for maintenance, you know, that little yellow sticker comes up there, it's like people think it's going to rain donuts, and then it comes back 20 minutes later and nothing happens.
Sorry, false alarm.
And yet we're all going, oh, well.
Thanks, Chris. No, I'm going to be hungry every time the Apple store goes down.
I had my finger out ready to get one right through the middle, and I got
there. Are certain blogs that do the obligatory "the Apple store is down" post.
Yeah, Apple store is down. Apple store is down. And loads of donuts. No donuts.
It's like, do you think it's a good thing they don't freak out every time the retail stores close every night? Like, oh my God, the stores are closed. Maybe tomorrow morning there'll be a new product.
Could be stocking new products.
Yeah, I mean, they could be revving their code, or who knows what they're doing. But you know, the idea is, I think I've run into a couple of people say, well, yeah, Apple's not here. And yeah, well, that was last year. Apple isn't here, and they're not going to be here. And so let's look at what the show is now.
And Apple's right up the street. I mean, and it's right up your street, too, right? I mean,
right. And that's what they, nicely or not so nicely, Phil Schiller basically said, you know, we have an expo every single day at the App Store. Now, I don't happen to agree with that, but that's their line, you know. And so they're not going to say, oh, well, actually, it's not the same thing. And, you know, people who come here and attend these things and talk with other people and meet vendors that aren't carried in the Apple store know that. They know this is a different thing. Or being able to go over and talk directly to the iOS developer that developed a certain app, either to have them pitch you on it and sell it to you, or so you have the opportunity to say, my life is better because I spent $4 for your whatever that you made. My life is easier. Thank you so much. And you can't do that at an Apple store.
Well, you know, I've talked to some of the developers who are here, and one of the big things they've said that's different this year and partly last year was that in years past, a good chunk, if not a majority of the people who were here to see the Apple booth. And then they wandered around the show floor and stopped in and talked to people. But it was kind of like, we're here because we were pulled in by Apple. But the people coming last year and this year, they knew Apple was not going to be here. I mean, you knew not to expect them. And so you knew what to expect. And I don't want to say you're all better people than the people who were here in the past. But the vendors have said that essentially.
But you are.
The way quality to work the crowd.
The quality of interactions they're having with people is better because you're serious people. You're not just window shopping because you were here to see the big event and you just happen to be walking the floor. You're here to see them. And they love it. I mean, I've gotten nothing but positive feedback this show from the people who are at the booth saying the people have been great. They're asking questions. They're interested. We're not in the coattails of Apple here. Well, we are basically
more to
our own.
And more to the point for many of them, they're selling, you know, people are buying stuff. And I talked to a couple of vendors who are like, oh yeah, this is great. You know, people come by, they look at the product, they get a chance to test it out. And more often than not, it seems like they're actually buying it.
There's an opportunity for these smaller vendors to shine now that they might not have in years past. And I think if there's a silver lining to that. I think that those are some of the positives.
I never really understood the whole. I mean, before there were Apple retail stores, I understood it. But in recent years, it's true. The Apple booth tended to be a whole bunch of things that you could already see.
Right.
With the exception of, you know, the iPhone in the glass case that everybody went, ah. But well, other than that,
you couldn't buy anything, right? Like you could look at stuff, but
right,
you couldn't.
At least at the Apple Store, you could actually buy it, right? So it did. It was sort of redundant, and it did divert people's attention away from the rest of the show, where there were things that you, a lot of which you can't even see at an Apple retail store, and things that'll surprise you. So in many ways, I mean, I had this conversation with a person on our staff who will remain nameless, who said, you know, in my opinion, I am glad that Apple isn't there, and I hope they never come back because the show floor is better without them, which is a very bold statement. But there is something to that. If you're everybody who isn't Apple, it's better without them because then people don't come in and just wander around the giant Apple booth and see the products that are at the Apple store and then leave.
Yeah, I think it's an interesting dynamic, and I think this is something that's going to build over years, that last year some people just made the commitment. We're going to be there. We're going to support the community, whatever that is, and hopefully you get more attention because Apple's not here. There were some people who sat it out, and you talk to the vendors and say, are you going to come or not? And they go, well, we're going to see how it goes. Basically, is it going to flop or not? It didn't. More vendors came back. We also have a huge addition of iOS vendors who can do this less expensively and show off good gear, and they talk all day, and they sell a lot of stuff. And I think next year, again, we're going to see another influx of vendors. Maybe we'll never see Adobe again.
Yeah, well, we'll see how the economy does, too. Because, I mean, the thing is, I'm not convinced how... I don't know how easy it is to pick apart the departure of Apple from the fact that the economy cratered. I think both of those... Going to a trade show is expensive. And for some of these small companies, and a lot of the Mac accessory and iOS accessory companies and software companies are very small companies. Right. And it's a... Going to San Francisco, flying, hotel, paying for your booth, all of that, personnel to run the booth, it is expensive. And so in a bad economy... and in the questions, the turmoil about the show, you know, that is a double whammy. So in some ways, it's kind of amazing that it is here. And we talked 2 years ago, the last Apple show. I remember us sitting in the Macworld booth, high atop the aquarium that we broadcast from, about would this be it, and would we ever see it again? And we all remember what happened when Apple moved, or when Apple didn't come to Macworld on the East Coast Boston,
right.
And there was 1 year. And it was
a
ghost town.
Year,
and, you know, the fact was last year it wasn't like that here. This year it's not like that here. So it is not at all the same story, which is great.
Well, it's a tough proposition, too, because if you compare to other trade shows that exist, there's nothing quite like it, right? There's not really any other trade shows dedicated to products from one company, or, like, you know, products built around one company. There's, you know, you have your CES, which is enormous and has everybody from the electronic space. You have your game expos like E3, for example. But there really aren't a lot of conferences or get-togethers really focused around, you know, one company.
At least not ones that are consumer-focused.
Right, right.
I
mean, you have
ones,
developer conferences and things like that.
Ones where the average person
but
can
to
come,
open to
right.
the, and even CES is not really, is only slightly open sort of to the average person. And so I think that's, you know... Again, it's sort of a lasting testament to the fact that Apple has long been a community-based, that there's some sort of community around its products going back all the way to 1984, if not before. And so I think that there's still a very strong feeling in that, and as new people come into, become customers and Apple users, whether it be for the Mac or the iPhone or what have you, I think there is sort of a feeling of welcoming and community to that, and I think that, you know, there's certainly a potential for as many people as we lost, maybe, who were, you know, not showing up because Apple's not here. I think you still end up gaining a lot from people who are new to the whole scene.
Well, it'd be interesting to see what effect the Mac App Store has on Expo next year. Because much like the iOS area, where you have small developers who didn't exist until the platform existed, and now you've got the Mac App Store where... like the people behind Pixelmator, for example. What, they made $1 million in a couple of weeks?
Yeah, less than a month.
Yeah, and prior to that, you would find out about this software by reading Mac Gems, because Dan would scour the world and find these absolutely wonderful utilities that have moved beyond just being sort of shareware, which you sort of think, oh, some guy made it in his basement. And
are you saying I might be losing my job now, Chris?
No, your job is going to get harder. Because now
it's
this
been
stuff
good knowing you, Dan.
Because now it's featured, you know, and they are on this playing field now that is like nothing else they had before, because it isn't so much about the box and putting boxes on shelves. Now it's getting your thing in front of people on the Mac App Store, and now here's an, you know, rising out of the depths is now this entire new generation of developers who get some attention, who are now a big deal just because they made really great software that Apple thought, this is good, let's feature this stuff. and I see them being here too. So now maybe we don't have big booths, but now we just have more of these smaller areas instead of, you know, somebody trying to show off a box or a printer. Yes? You could just nod and say, yes, you're right.
That sounds good, Chris.
Let's talk
far
about
out,
else.
Man.
Okay.
Yeah. No, no, I see what you're saying. It could go either way, right? You could say, well, the Mac App Store, I'm in the store. I'm in front of every single Mac user who's running Snow Leopard or Lion.
Right.
And every new Mac that's sold. And so, you know, why do I need some other way for people to find me? Or you could say, you know, that it's going to draw more Mac developers. The other difference is that the Mac App Store isn't exclusive like the iOS store. So you could be a Mac App Store developer who's also got it separately,
right,
and come here with, you know, with CDs or flash drives or whatever, and sell your app right on the show
floor. For $20 instead of $30, and you keep all of it.
And you keep all the money instead of giving it to Apple. So, you know, it could go either way. Or it could just be a, you know, kind of a steady rise.
Well, and it's important to keep in mind that both app stores, both the Mac and iOS app stores, remember, you know, especially the iOS app store, the volume is so huge. How do you make yourself stand out when there's 300,000 applications on a store or, you know, any number of thousand on the Mac App Store? And the answer is, well, you know, aside from getting featured by Apple, which is great for a lot of these developers, you need, you know, it's good to have some place to be where you can interact directly with customers.
Well, and let's also say, not to toot our own horn, but there are lots of members of the media who come to Macworld Expo, and they go over and they meet some app developer that they've never heard of, and they write a story about it, and five of their colleagues for other websites write stories about it, which the people read, and then that drives sales, and that gets them on the chart, and then they make a lot of money on the Mac App Store or the iOS App Store. So getting publicity by being at a place where there are lots of customers and there are lots of media is not a bad thing.
Speaking of publicity, and since we have the four of us gathered here, and since...
Are you publicizing something?
I'm going to publicize our Macworld Reader.
Oh.
Because this was unveiled last
Tuesday.
Tuesday. We did a little preview of it earlier in the week, but it was early in the morning, and we were running it from the iPad. And I think, how many of you have downloaded Macworld Reader?
People seen the Macworld Daily Reader?
Yeah.
Nice.
And so where
Thank
is it
you.
On the charts now? It's like still number one? Or?
Well, PBS, I'm going to curse Elmo. Damn you, Elmo! PBS, I believe, has the number one free app on the iPad as of this morning.
Okay.
But we had a good run. We had 3 days at number one. We went past Angry Birds. I think we're now at number two. So the birds have the bronze right now. but yeah, so it's been great. We got more than 100,000 downloads in a couple of days. So pretty impressive. Now, of course, that's a 1.0. So now it's up to us to keep improving it. But the idea is to create that, you know, create an iPad reading experience. That's mm-hmm. something that's more more current than a monthly magazine in digital form, which, you know, you can do that. You can get your monthly magazine in print. You can get it on digital using the Zinio app. But also we wanted the Daily Reader app to be richer than the pure website experience. The, you know, website experience, you can do that. You can go to our website on the iPad. You can tap, load the page, read the article, tap the back button, scroll down, find another thing, tap on it. You can do that. But first off, we post 25 stories a day.
Right.
And the web experience isn't necessarily the most kind of optimal experience because it is a web browser, and there are things you can do in apps that you can't do in a web browser. So we built this app. Every story we post, the editors actually choose, you all know, because you've seen the tools and that we have, our friend called Tulips that we use to post all of our stories. What a pleasant name for a very complicated tool. Every story we post on Macworld.com and post to the iPad app as well, not only can we choose whether it goes to the iPad app only or it goes to Macworld.com or both, but we prioritize it. So basically, we're curating the entire site on the fly. We're saying highest priority, high priority, normal, low, lowest. Lowest is great. That's like, I'm posting the story. Please don't read it. And then the app takes that into account. So instead of seeing this fire hose of 25 stories over the course of a day, what happens is there's this algorithm that looks at how long ago was the story posted and how highly rated was it by the editor who posted it. Or by the other editor who came later and said, no, that's not that
important. This explains why I don't see any of my pieces on the site
anymore. Yes, that's right. You're automatically deprioritized, Dan. So anyway, it does that. And as a result, if you're one of these people who says, you know, I love Macworld the magazine, but I go to the website and you know, it's this list of stories, and it's like 40 stories that were posted in the last day and a half, and I don't even know. There's so much. I mean, some people love that.
Right.
And we love those readers who love the fire hose. Other people don't. So we called it Daily Reader to imply. I mean, it updates all the time, but to imply that it's something that's more timely than monthly, but is not that, you know, I'm going to check every minute and see what's new.
Right.
There is a live view in it that if you tap, you see sort of this Twitter list that we built of people who are, you know, kind of cool Mac-related and Apple-related people on Twitter, and our RSS feed is in there too. So if you want to see what's happening right now, you can. But that's, you know, the point is that it lets you take a step back and sort of say, oh, you know, once or twice a day, what's going on with Apple and the Mac? And it is choosing what to show you based on what the editors think is the most important, combined with timeliness. So, you know, if a big news story happens on Monday, some, you know, major product is unveiled, and then you don't check till Wednesday, on our website, you know, that story scrolled off.
Right.
On the Daily Reader, it'll be on the front page because some editor will have said this is the highest priority,
yeah. And
that gives it staying power. So it's not as if we're like handpicking every day, I want this story here. It is a computer program that's doing it, but it's doing it with all the input of the editors. So I hope people like it, and they should also know that we are very well aware that it's a 1.0 product, and we have a huge list of things we want to do, but this is, we really worked on it for like 11 months, I think. My first memo about what we should do on the iPad was 11 months ago, almost exactly to the day that we released it. So
right,
it's,
because the
it was a lot of work.
The iPad was announced before Expo last year.
Right, a little more than a year ago.
We have a session where I'll call to ask the editors, and people come and ask us questions about what we do. And the first question was probably asked three times, what are you going to do on the iPad? And it took from February till now, basically, to say
right.
this.
Right, right. Well, I mean, one month in, so February of last year, the end of February last year, I wrote this thing and sent it around to a bunch of people at the office that said, I'm not convinced that the whole, you know, a digital replica of the print magazine with some extra wissy stuff embedded in it is the right way to go. Because we do so much on the web, and because when I think about the iPad, I don't think that replicating a paper medium is right. That's like staging in the early days of TV, they moved cameras into theaters and recorded plays going
right.
on stage. And that's the old medium on new medium, and it's a transitory thing, and it goes away. So we decided that Zinio was going to do that anyway for us. And building their app for the print magazine. We were going to do something different. And then from there, it took, again, 11 months, really, of you know, user interface development and trying to conceive of what it would be and dropping off all the features that we couldn't ship in time and going through the approval process with Apple, which was complicated.
Mm-hmm.
And anybody who's read stories about magazine publishers who've had a hard time figuring out exactly how to work with Apple on giving subscribers access and selling things inside the app and all that, we ran into all of that. It was a very complicated thing. It's still not really fully resolved.
Right.
So, yeah, turns out developing apps is hard. And all of my developer friends go, ha, 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 now you know. But I'm hoping the reception is good. So far it's been pretty good, and I hope people like it and also tell us what they think could be better about it, because we have our list, but we know that there are things on it that, or that should be on it that aren't.
Right. Okay, and now switching gears yet again, I want to go look at the live audience here and say, how many of you would come back to Macworld next year?
Macworld 2012.
2012. That's a good turnout.
Yeah. If the world doesn't end.
If the world does not end.
I don't think it ends.
Is it supposed to happen after?
I think it's the end of 2012.
Oh, good. Oh, who?
I think we're all right.
So we get one.
The last Macworld next year, for sure.
Oh, no. Yes.
So
somebody's going to quote you.
You absolutely must come.
Before the Mayan Armageddon happens.
Yeah, and just to be fair, how many of you would not come back next year? Nicely
right.
done. That's very well, except Ted Landau back there said, "No, I'm not coming. It's a BART ride for me." And those of you streaming at home, I'm not sure which camera it is. It doesn't really matter. We can see each and every one of you. So how many of you will be coming here next year? Just raise your virtual hand. Thank you, Dave. Okay, so they're all coming too. So it's going to be
everybody on the live stream is coming.
Everyone in the live stream nice. Now is going to be coming as well. And so this place is going to be.
We're going to need a bigger boat.
Yeah, well, I'm going to put my name on this chair and a piece of a duct tape upon, you know, and normally it would have been John Gruber's chair, but he never shows up when you reserve a place. This is a totally inside joke. So inside.
Yes, I hope the people out there on the live stream really appreciated the shirt that John Gruber wore when he was on stage here on Thursday, too, which fortunately the internet is not regulated by the FCC, and therefore indecent language on shirts can just go on the internet.
Yeah, well, he pretty much got the headshot after.
Yeah. If you're wondering why he's framed rather tightly and you can only see his neck.
There was some colorful language on his T-shirt, which is, is so John.
That's so John Gruber.
Yeah. So, we have a few minutes. And we will take questions, unless you want to argue with us about Apple coming back to the here, and we just won't talk about that. So, anyone have a question about Expo and our gentleman? How about the gentleman in the blue?
And we
cap?
Got a man with a microphone too, okay. Jim Hopkins.
Yeah. Hello. Can you hear me? They can't hear you. It's not hot. Okay. What about the Mac Daily Reader? I mean, your Macworld Daily Reader 2 from the iPod Touch and iPhone also. I mean, there's still a lot of us out there that don't have our iPads because we're waiting for version 2 or 3.
Right. See, you ask that question, I just want to collapse in a heap. It's like, oh, God. I think what I'd say is that we developed the app because we felt like the iPad screen being larger, it was good for that that kind of reading experience. What for the iPhone and the iPod Touch, what we're going to be doing is trying to really improve the quality of the site that we serve, the website that we serve that to WebKit browsers, just specifically the mobile WebKit browsers on the iPhone and the iPod Touch, which we do have a custom version of that now. It's a little bare bones. It's not bad, but there are a lot of things it doesn't do. So I'd say that in the short term, what we're going to try to do is make the mobile web version of Macworld.com better, rather than bring the app to the to those platforms. It's possible we would in the future, but I think we've got a lot of things we want to do on the iPad before we would try to bring it. And I'm not sure it would translate. And if we boiled it down to something that's just on the iPhone, I'm not sure it would be much better than the mobile version of the website at that point. So there are things you could do in HTML5. We're looking into that, but that may be how we go about it on the iPhone and the iPod Touch.
Another question?
Any thoughts on Rupert Murdoch's forthcoming iPad app?
Oh, you should have come to our session yesterday.
Oh yeah, we
many many thoughts.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting. I hope that he's negotiated a good deal for publishers with Apple, because the rest of us might be able to jump on the bandwagon there. I'm going. So check out Macworld.com next Wednesday.
I think it's Wednesday
at 11 a.m. Eastern. From New York.
Wait, what time is that? Hold on, I'm in the wrong time zone.
Yeah, it's 8 a.m. here. You're going to have to get up early.
Oh,
ha-ha. Could be, I'm encouraged by the fact that he actually is creating something that isn't encumbered by an existing staff, existing subscribers. It's it really is that what if. What if there was a brand new media entity backed by somebody who's got money that was designed just for the iPad? So I'm interested. I'm looking forward to it. But I think it also is interesting because it may affect what the deal is with Apple and other publishers. And that is big for everybody else, not just Rupert
Murdoch. And this is what we were talking about earlier in terms of, it'll be interesting to see whether Apple is going to be turning around and offering some tools to publishers to make their content more easily accessible or to work with things like subscriptions, et cetera. And I think we're all hoping and perhaps expecting them to see something along those lines next week. But yeah, it's a good thing that it's Rupert Murdoch doing it, because there's somebody there who can. You're gonna need somebody who's at least gonna stand toe to toe with Steve Jobs to a certain extent and to the rest of Apple. So I think that like we were talking about in our editor session yesterday, the one thing we know is that Rupert Murdoch probably likes making money, and Apple also likes making money. So if they can find a way to do that together, then well, hopefully it will turn out well.
Okay, I think we have time for one more question.
One question is about this is becoming more of a consumer show. So what about shifting it so that it had both the Saturday and the Sunday as well? Because not so many people can come at the weekend. The weekend is the ideal time for consumers to come when they're not at work. And now it's only one day, not 2 days.
Well, I actually asked Paul Kent, who runs the expo, and he said that last year was the first time in a long time they did it on a weekend. and attendance was down on Saturday compared to the other days. So I think a lot of people who come, it is consumer oriented, but a lot of people come here on the company dime, so to speak. But they did make more effort this year to advertise the show to a consumer market and to other markets where a weekend would be a better time. And I think they're looking to see how that turns out.
So I think the attendance today has been good, better than last year, in fact.
Definitely, yeah.
It helps that it's not a nice sunny day out there, and it was last year on the Saturday. I'm skeptical that they would ever do it on a Sunday. I think the big thing is to make, if they're going to keep doing it on a Saturday, because it is funny. Yes, strangely, a lot of people like saying, I'm gonna leave work and go to Macworld Expo and learn some important things about computers and technology that I can apply to my job, right, boss? And so they come on Thursday or Friday instead. But I know Paul Ken's paying attention to it, so when I talk to him, I'll ask him.
And this is actually the last session that we of Macworld Magazine, Macworld.com, have here at the stage. There are more sessions coming up, so stick around. But I did want to say from us to the Ustream people that have been doing this stream for us all week, these guys completely rock.
Yeah.
The audio
and the video crew, yeah, just pros. I don't know if you guys have had a chance to see it live on the site, but on the site it looks fantastic.
It sounds great. It looks way better than it does in person. We all look better, more handsome.
It's shocking how good they make us look, and we're gonna save the stuff and put it on the site next week too, so you'll be able to play it back when you get home, so you can relive the magic of this. Or maybe you'll just watch something else.
This very
moment. Yes, it'll be exciting. No, just a fantastic job. And to Jim Hopkins from Macworld, who's been sort of running it behind the scenes, too.
Absolutely. Jim put it together, and he's done a fantastic job.
And to Chris for being a host.
Yeah, and booking all the guests.
I've been here every so often. And then also Panasonic. Look at that thing.
Yes, thanks to Panasonic for the 8-million-inch TV.
I get to take that home, right?
Yes.
It's bigger than your home.
If you can lift it, you can take it. But it's
bigger than my home, sadly.
Yeah, it's great. So we'd like to thank Panasonic for loaning that to us so we could have it here on the stage. And last but not least, and of course, thank all of you for coming to these sessions. We've been packed every single one. And people that have been tuning in at home on your computers, thank you very much for watching. We really appreciate it. And we look forward to seeing you next year.
Okay. Thanks, everybody.